This particular session will be divided into two parts. Part one, I will discuss in detail about the examination pattern, the eligibility, and the selection criteria. In part two, the discussion will be regarding preparation for general studies. Part two will be divided into 8 different modules. One will deal with introduction to the general studies syllabus. Module two will deal with the specific subject, that is the first one, the current events of national and international importance. Module three will deal with history of India and Indian national movement part of the general studies syllabus. Module 4 will focus on the Indian and the world geography component. Module 5 will discuss on Indian polity and governance aspects. Module 6 will be on economic and social development. Module 7 will deal with certain general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity, and climate change. Module 8 will talk about general science. Then we have interaction with the participants. May I request the participants to kindly be on mute? Because it will cause echo. All the participants, please be on mute. Thank you.
Sir, turn the speaker on.
If the participants do not meet, we will have no other alternative to close it.
Yes, sir.
No other alternative to close the session.
Yes.
For a few, we cannot be for the others. Ground to force, rather force to keep you out who are not unmuting.
Thank you. The Union Public Service Commission of UPSC conducts a combined geoscientist examination for recruitment and selection to the post of geologist, geophysicist, and chemist in Group A services in Geological Survey of India. For the junior hydrogeologist of Group A, for the Central Groundwater Board, the selection is based on a competitive examination which will be held in 3 stages. The preliminary examination, which is going to be the stage 1. The mains examination, which is the stage 2, and the personality test, or popularly known as interview session, which will be conducted as per the revised scheme, which is in function from 2020 onwards. Admission at all the stages of the examination will be purely provisional, subject that the candidates will satisfy the prescribed eligibility conditions. Let us come to part one of the plan of the examination. The part one or stage one of the combined geoscientist preliminary examination is going to be a computer-based objective paper. It will consist of 400 marks. Paper 1 will be related to general studies. The duration is 2 hours and the maximum marks for this paper are 100. Paper 2 will be as per the stream-wise subject, which again is of 2 hours duration. However, the maximum marks are 300. Therefore, the candidates may kindly note that they have more marks. They have more marks for the subject. The stream-wise subjects will be for geology and hydrogeology for stream 1. For stream 2, it is the geophysics. For stream 3, it is chemistry. May I request the participants to kindly make a note of the fact that there will be negative marking for any wrong answers provided in the preliminary multiple objective type test. Therefore, 1/3 of the marks which have been allotted to a particular question will be deducted as a penalty if a wrong answer is provided. Therefore, I request the participants to kindly ensure that you are very much in cognizance of the correct answer before you pen down your choice. Because for unanswered questions, there will not be any penalty. Therefore, if you are not sure about the answer and you are also not able to work upon the elimination technique, which I will talk about later, to deduct the right answer, instead of getting a penalty of negative mark, it would be wise not to answer a particular question if you are not aware of the correct answer. Let us now move on to stage 2 of the combined geoscientist examination mains part. This particular part will be of conventional subjective paper. There are going to be 3 papers of 200 marks each. Therefore, the combined marks will be 600. Paper 1, paper 2 and paper 3, all the 3 subject papers will be of 3 hours duration and 200 marks each. Stream 1 will be of geology and hydrogeology. Stream 2 will be of geophysics papers, and for stream 3, the participants will be appearing for the chemistry papers. Therefore, this particular mains written examination is extremely important because it also has a larger share of marks to ensure that the candidate enters the final merit list. The participants must give due consideration and preparation for the mains subjective examination, for which they must go for a thorough study. The stage 3 of the examination is the personality test or interview. The marks allotted for this is 200. Needless to say, this is also an extremely important part to ensure your grading in the final merit list tally. Definitely please make sure that the marks which you get in the interview session will determine your ranking in the UPSC Combined Geoscientist Examination merit list. And this seniority of your merit position will be there throughout your career in Geological Survey of India or Central Groundwater Board. So kindly ensure that you go thoroughly prepared for your personality test or interview. Let us now discuss about the eligibility criteria for appearing in this examination. The nationality of the candidate is the first criteria. The candidate must either be a bona fide citizen of India. He may also be a subject of Nepal, Bhutan, or a Tibetan refugee who has come to India before the 1st January 1962 and has an intention of permanently settling in India. Some other persons who are also allowed include a person of Indian origin. Take a note, a person of Indian origin who has migrated from either Pakistan, Burma, Sri Lanka, East African countries like Kenya, Uganda, United Republic of Tanzania, Zambia, Malawi, Zaire, Ethiopia, or Vietnam, again with the intention of permanently settling in India. So if you have this eligibility criteria, you are allowed to appear for the examination. Regarding the eligibility conditions relating to the age limit, let me ensure that for age limit, for the geologist and the hydrogeologist paper who are appearing for this particular post, for the geophysicist and the chemist in Group A, you will be required to attain the age of 21 years, but not that of 32 years, as on the 1st of January, say 2021, if the examination is being conducted, or whatever is the year of the examination, accordingly, for that particular year of examination, the candidate must have attained the age of 21 years and not have attained the age of 22 years, that is 21 to 31, you will be eligible to appear for the examination. However, certain relaxation is also granted. For example, in the case of ex-servicemen or candidates belonging to the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe, as mentioned in the constitution list, 5 years age relaxation is granted. Candidates belonging to the backward class, that is OBC category, 3 years age relaxation is allowed. For any members of the deaf, mute, blind, or orthopedically disabled category in the physically handicapped category, 10 years of age relaxation is allowed. Please note, the number of attempts is not limited. The age is here the important criteria. Regarding the educational qualifications, for geologist in Group A in GSI, the candidates must have a master's degree in geological science, geology, applied geology, or geo-exploration, mineral exploration, engineering geology, earth sciences, marine geology, oceanography, coastal area studies, geological technology, petroleum geosciences or exploration, or geophysical technology, any of the geology and the allied subjects from a recognized university. For posting to junior hydrogeologist, scientist B post in Central Groundwater Board, the candidate must possess a master's degree in geology, applied geology, or marine geology from a recognized university. When you appear for the preliminary or stage one examination, only the candidates who will qualify this stage will be eligible to write the mains or stage 2 examination. Please make a note that the candidates which are called for the mains examination will be around 6 to 7 times of the number of vacancies for that particular post in that specific year. So in whichever year, as the number of posts are there, 6 to 7 times of that post, the candidates who qualify the preliminary examination will be asked to appear for the mains examination. Again, in order to qualify in the written examination, a candidate must secure the minimum qualifying marks which have been allocated for each paper. They must also secure the total marks which should be more than the cutoff which has been decided for that particular paper on that particular aspect. The candidates who qualify the mains examination will then be allowed to appear for the interview. The final merit list which will be prepared will be a combined effort which the candidate has put in the preliminary mains as well as the interview part of the examination. Therefore, it is extremely important that you put in your best efforts and give your best shot at the preliminary examination, because the marks will be counted for determining the position in the merit list. Give your best shot at the written stage 2 mains examination as well as the interview or personality test. This will ensure your success, and I'm sure that you will come out with flying colors in this UPSC combined geoscientist examination. With this, we have completed part one of this session, which was dealing with the plan of the examination and the eligibility criteria which is required to appear for this particular examination. We will now go ahead and prepare and see how we can go for the effective preparation for the general studies paper. In this context, we will be having a particular session which is exclusively dedicated to the preparation of general studies. The learning objectives for this session are to provide guidance regarding the syllabus and the focus areas for general studies preparation. The study and the reference material which are required for all the 7 topics which are mentioned in the general studies paper. We will also have certain tips for GS preparation. Here, may I require that candidates pay adequate attention to all the aspects which are of utmost importance to ensure a leverage as far as the preparation for general studies is concerned. We make a note that candidates will be available for appearing for this general studies paper, and they need to ensure getting more marks than the counterparts so that they have a success ratio. So here we will be going ahead and we will be studying as to how you can get a distinct advantage for preparation. And this will ensure that you have a better mark scoring capacity as compared to other candidates. So let us now start one by one. The first aspect will be to get introduced to the general studies paper, the syllabus part. In the syllabus, it is mentioned that one must be aware about the current events which have national as well as international importance in the scenario. One must be thorough with the history of India and specifically the Indian national movement, which was to attain the freedom for India. A candidate should have knowledge for the Indian as well as world geography as far as the
Ma'am, you're breaking.
Check a moment, please. Just give me a second, sir. Is it fine now, sir? Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much to all of you for responding. Shilpa, Sonam, Gaurav, Ashok. Thank you all. Thank you all. So let us start ahead. Yeah, so I was talking about the Constitution of India. As expected from an educated person who has not made a special study of political science subject, but being educated, responsible citizen of a democratic country, the largest democracy in the world, he or she should have a specific knowledge about the political system, the Panchayati Raj, the various public policies which are prepared from time to time by the government of India for the benefit of the people, the rights of the people, and of course their duties also. The next expectancy of the commission is that one should be thorough with the economic and social development aspects of the country. Therefore, the various economical, the challenges being faced by the Indian economy, the coping measures, the strides, the success, and various schemes in the social development sector, they should be taken care of. General issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity, climate change, greenhouse gases, chlorofluorocarbons, ozone holes, all these kind of general environmental issues a person should be aware of. And of course, general science. You should be aware of the basic principles of physics, mathematics, biology, chemistry, the latest inventions, the latest discoveries in the field of scientific technology development, So you should be thorough with all these aspects. Once we are aware of the syllabus of general studies, let us now take each topic in much more detail one by one. So first is the current events of national and international importance. These current events are I will give certain suggestions and provide guidance as to how one can prepare for the general studies paper. However, the material which is available for the preparation of general studies in the market is quite exhaustive and also easily available. So there will not be much problem as far as the general studies for current events preparation is concerned, if a candidate follows the advice of reading a minimum of 2 national dailies, especially the editorial part in which all the important national and international events are discussed in a threadbare manner. They are discussed from the perspectives of a particular nation as well as the impact on the international community. Therefore, reading 2 national newspapers daily, especially the editorials, for example, the Hindu, the Indian Express, Times of India, whatever you are reading, whatever you are comfortable, a newspaper which covers both the national as well as the international news segment, including the sports component, the awards, can be taken up. Also, you are required to listen news on television channels or some mobile apps. Therefore, whenever you are listening to news channels, or having or reading the news on your apps, it will keep you abreast of all the development. Are available easily. As I already said, the exhaustive coverage is taken in a number of publications, but for suggested limited reading, I may suggest Lucent General Knowledge Book, as I have shown here. May I suggest Health Publication General Knowledge Book? So you can take any one of them, and it will definitely give an exhaustive coverage for the major current events of national and international events. Certain current affair magazines which are available easily, you can subscribe to them. For example, the Chronicle or the Pratiyogita Darpan. You can also go for regional language magazines. If you are working in some other language, then definitely you can take the Hindi version of them or the Tamil or the Telugu. So these are some good magazines and reference books which can be used for preparing for the current events which have cast an important influence on the past year for which the questions will be asked. Then there are certain online sources. This Lucent General Knowledge Book you need not purchase. It's not required. The same book is available as a free PDF download. So you can just go to Lucent General Knowledge sslive.co.in and you will be able to download the book and you can read it. So it's not required to spend a lot. You can simply, you know, just download the book and read it. I will request the participants to practice mock test on current affairs. And you can go to www.edudose.com or CrackU app or ExamVeda app. And these will give you certain, you know, questions like MCQ types. And these you can try to practice on and off on a monthly basis so that you keep yourself abreast of the latest events. Now, once we have understood about the various segments where you can study and the kind of reference material online as well as offline you can have, let us have a look at some of the sample questions which can be asked from this segment and see how we will be able to tackle them. And these are some of the sample questions. For example, Surya Kiran is a joint military exercise between the militaries of India and. So you need to have a thorough reading of the newspaper to understand that India conducted a joint military exercise with Nepal, which was named as Surya Kiran. So the another question, for example, these are the sample questions which have been taken from the UPSC Combined Geoscientist Examination of 2020 and 2021, which was conducted recently. So the Indian Astronomical Union has named an asteroid after a singer. What is that singer? So you have options, and it is in fact Pandit Jasraj, after whose name it has come. So these kind of news, they keep on coming in the newspaper, and they'll also be available in the magazines, current affairs and GK book. Football team of which country was defeated by the Indian team to win the South Asian Football Federation Under 18 Championship? And who is the first woman officer of the Indian Air Force to be appointed as the flight commander? So you should know that Shalisa Dhami is the to grace the honor. So these are the kind of questions you expect. Coming to the second part, that is history of India and the Indian national movement. So when we're talking about history of India, see, as an educated Indian, it's extremely important that you make note of the fact that we must be aware of our proud and rich our history, and especially the freedom struggle of India in the which is covered in the Indian National Movement part. So for the history, you must be, you know, aware of the entire ancient history of India, starting from the Indus Valley Civilization, all the Mauryan Empire, Gupta Empire, all ancient stuff with the literature also, who wrote them. The medieval history of India with the Mughals, you should have a thorough knowledge of the medieval history. I would suggest to give a good focus on the administrative developments in India during the British period from 1650 to 1857, that is pre the 1857 rebellion, or as somebody calls it, as the first war of Indian independence. So before that, how the administrative development was there, and after 1857 rebellion, when the British crown took over the administration from the East India Company, what were the developments later on? So the entire national movement from 1800 culminating in the final freedom of our great country, that is in 1947, the entire Indian national movement, the various administrative laws and developments, and especially, you know, post 1919, the freedom movement, the struggle, the various movements which were taken up under the able guidance of the father of the nation, respected Sri Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. And there are a number of frequently FAQ, I mean the frequently asked questions from 1919 to 1947 part of the Indian national struggle. And for this part, you can definitely make a study from the NCERT textbooks. Now, let me repeat this. I will be telling this repeatedly, that the NCERT books from the 9th to the 12th standard are the basic reference material where you are supposed to make a study. For NCERT, specifically if you talk about national movement part, class 12, modern India book jo hai, that is very good to help you in these last three parts, you know, 1800 to 1947, the latest part of the freedom struggle, it is good. So kindly make a thorough study of the NCERT textbooks from 9 to 12. This is your basic material. It will prepare a foundation. Now, based on this foundation, you can keep on developing your skills, your information, your knowledge. If you want to do further studies, if you want to do further study on a specific aspect, then you can go for India Struggle for Independence by Bipin Chandra. It's an excellent book. You can go for the Spectrum book for a brief history of modern India by Rajiv Ahir. This will help you to give more insight into the intricacies of the various the movements taken up by the Indian National Congress during the freedom struggle, the various sessions of the Indian National Congress, and what were the main objectives, the main resolutions passed in those sessions. These are also extremely important. Now let us have a look at some of the questions which may be asked in this segment. For example, you can have some questions from the ancient history part, like life-size terracotta images of Ganga and Yamuna from 300 to 600 AD have been found at. So you have certain options. It's actually Achi Chhatra in Uttar Pradesh. Which group is known as the No Changer? Because when the Congress decided to contest elections for entry into the Legislative Council, then there were certain leaders under Mahatma Gandhi who were saying that, okay, let us not enter into the Legislative Council because still the Britishers are ruling the country. So who are known as the No Changers? Then, as I said, the sessions of the Indian National Congress, the Lahore session, which was held in 1929, is famous for what? So the sessions of the Indian National Congress, the location and the resolution passed. These are also very important segments. So here, actually, it was 1929 Lahore session. They adopted the Purna Swaraj as the objective of the Congress. So this was a resolution. Then in the medieval history, so you see that you have ancient history questions, medieval history questions, then Indian national movement and freedom struggle questions. So there will be a combination of questions. So let us look at this one. Jahangir got impressed by the Turkish fluency of which European traveler and made him a mansabdar of 400 servers. So it was William Hawkins who was very fluent in Turkish. So Jahangir was really impressed. So these are the kind of things sometimes. The questions may be such that you may not be quite aware of many of them, but okay. Nevertheless, you should be aware of the general parts of the history, especially the national movement. Now, coming to the Indian and world geography part. See, geography is going to be of specific importance because you are appearing for a combined geoscientist examination. So definitely, you expect that not senso stricto geology, but nevertheless, the Indian and the world geography will be given due importance. So, yes, definitely an important aspect rahega aapke preparation ka, where you are required to have a thorough understanding. So, definitely, you make arrangements for a proper study of this. So talking about the Indian and the world geography, you should be aware of the Indian geography, the physiographic divisions, the political divisions, the states, the important cities, their importance, the economic importance, the social development sector, the social demography of India and also of the world, the physical divisions of India and that of the world, the important rivers, lakes, mountain chains, specific interest of geographic locations, the geomorphology, the economic geography. So all these are going to be of specific importance. Sometimes the certain questions regarding the origin of the earth, the universe, the specific structure of the earth, the internal structure of the earth, the various parts, the discontinuities, the occurrence of certain elements in specific layers of the Earth's interior. So all these kind of questions are asked as far as the geography is concerned. The reference material which you can use, definitely the NCERT textbooks from 9th to 11th are going to form the basis. May I request the participants to be on mute, please? We are getting a lot of background sound. Thank you so much for responding. So, as I said, the NCERT textbooks from 9 to 12 are going to find the foundation. It is your foundation for particular study. And on this foundation, you will be building up the further reference material if you are using. So you can have this. Let us go to some of the sample questions for the Indian geography. A spit can be defined as, and there are certain, so it is basically a definition linked question. So a spit can be defined as a beach of sand which is linked at one end to the land and it is just extending into the sea. Which of the following states does not share boundary with Chhattisgarh? So this particular kind of question involves that you should be thorough with the map of India, especially the political map of India where the state boundaries are marked. So this will help you to understand Chhattisgarh is not in proximity and it is not sharing boundary with which particular Indian state. Which of the following statement about Marajo Island is not correct? So Marajo Island is one of the largest fluvial island which is located in Brazil in the Amazon River. So here, see, one place you are having some geomorphology question, physical geography, geomorphology. And here you are having a question related to Indian geography. Now this is a representative question related to world geography. In world geography, you know, Marajo Island, if you are aware of it, then you will understand to answer this question. Now, supposing you have a question on which Asian country is characterized by negative population growth. So here again, it is talking about the demography. So the demography, the social setup, the economic development, the physical part of the Indian and world geography, the geomorphological aspects, like you have a very good book by Shravendra Singh. So you can study that also for detail. But nevertheless, the NCERT text of geography from 9 to 12 is good enough to answer the geomorphological Indian and world geography questions. Let us come to another part, that is Indian polity and governance. So as I said, being a proud citizen of one of the world's largest democracy and a center of continuous political developments where all the sessions and the parliament sessions are recorded, they are of great interest. So being a part of that country, it's imperative that you make a thorough study of the entire political system which governs our country and how this particular governance is put into effect. Pillars of democracy in India run by the Constitution of India. So you should have an information on this part. Let us see in more detail. You should give special focus on certain segments of Indian polity. For example, Indian Parliament. So you should know the composition of the Parliament. And you should know how and what functions are performed by the different components of the Indian Parliament. What are the various rights and duties? And what are the main functional parameters as to which the segregation of the central subjects, the state subjects are decided as per the list of subjects mentioned in the Indian Constitution. Coming to public policy. See, public policy is something which, you know, keeps on changing as the governments change. They have their own particular important agenda and prerogatives. They have their vision, how to develop the country, to take the country to which level, what will be the direction of development, what will be the priority areas, how to ensure the well-being and goodness, how to ensure the success of democratic institutions, how to ensure the well-being, safety, health, security, prosperity of the citizens of India. So you should be aware about the public policies which are brought out by the government from time to time. The Panchayati Raj institution is a very unique and very important pillar, I should say, on which the success of a peaceful countryside, the success of peaceful resolution and proper development for the Gram Panchayats and Gram Sabha taking an active part in it, the proper development of the village people of India is concerned. And that is where the real India lives. The real India lives in the villages of India. And the maximum population is in the villages of India. The requirement for development, the requirement for carrying out government policies to ensure that the benefits of governance reach to the last and the every citizen, the lowest in the hierarchy, to every person in the remotest place in India. It may be the remote terrains of Ladakh and Northeast. It may be the forest inhabited by certain tribes. It may be a very remote village which has yet to get connected with the internet revolution or a proper road. It has to reach to the last person. Panchayati Raj institutions are instrumental in taking the policies from New Delhi to the remotest village in India, and definitely these are very important part of the questions. The Constitution of India is another important part, the solemn book by which the Indian democracy is run, according to which the governance is carried out in the country. Certain important segments are the fundamental rights of the citizens of India, the directive principles of state policy as to how the state has to function as a welfare state, ensuring prosperity, well-being, and development of citizens of India in social, moral, economic spheres, taking due care of the development of art, culture, and heritage, very rich heritage of India. The fundamental duties which are required to be performed by the citizens of India. For this, again, I would recommend NCERT books from 9th to 12th level for polity. If you want to go for further studies, you can study a book by M. Lakshmikant on Indian polity. So, you know, Indian polity by M. Lakshmikant, Parliament by Subhash Kashyap, Our Parliament by Subhash Kashyap, and M. Lakshmikant on Indian polity. Then the Constitution of India by P.M. Bakshi. These are some of the books you can refer. If you want to have more in-depth understanding and study regarding the Indian polity part, may I request the participants to please put it on mute. Thank you. So PM Bakshi, Constitution of India, Indian Polity by M. Lakshmikant, and Our Parliament by Subhash Kashyap, these latest editions, these are very good if you want an in-depth study, provided you have the time. Otherwise, NCERT textbooks are the very basic books. They can definitely be utilized. Let us see some of the sample questions. Which of the following articles of Indian Constitution deals with Uniform Civil Code? So since the Uniform Civil Code, why it should be implemented, whether it should be implemented, this all is in news. So you expect a question. So please remember that the questions on Indian polity, Indian history, geography, world geography are also related to certain news headlines, certain events, certain things which have been recently discussed. And that's why they have come into limelight, and therefore they are given due importance. And this is the reason that you have this question in your paper. So even the history and the political science questions can be related to current events. Another question, which committee on Panchayati Raj recommended a two-tier system of Panchayati Raj? So initially it was the Balwant Rai Mehta committee who gave a three-tier system, and then later on the Ashok Mehta committee recommended a two-tier system. So you have to be aware of the various developments in Panchayati Raj. Another question is, who determines if a particular subject matter is under which residuary power of the parliament? So actually you have the entire list of subjects which can be taken up by the center and by the states, and there are certain subjects which may not be there mentioned in the list, and it will be the Supreme Court of India who will be deciding as to who will be having the residuary power regarding that particular subject. Another question is, who among the following appoints the advocate general for a state? So if you know the various constitution posts and who appoints them, then accordingly you will be aware that the governor of the state is responsible for deputing and getting the appointment of the advocate general for that particular state. If you are aware of the constitution, if you are aware of various articles, the developments in the Panchayati Raj, if you are aware of the functions of the parliament and the constitutional post and commissions like the election commission, then the post like the advocate general, the attorney general, the comptroller and auditor general, or the CAG as we usually call it. So if you are aware of this, you will be able to successfully answer the questions in Indian polity. Now we'll come to the economic and social development. In economic and social development part, we have to be aware and about the economic development of the country which has taken place, and how the various social sector schemes are put by the government of India, for which segment they are required, and how they can be taken up for a proper understanding and for proper development of the citizens of India. Economic and social development, the entire concept of sustainable development, where you ensure development of economy along with providing jobs to the needy people and ensuring, due respect to the ecology, the environmental considerations, the poverty issues, the inclusion, bringing all the communities for the development, the demographics and the social sector initiatives, you should take care. For this, you can refer to Hindu. There is a special coverage on economic policies and social issues in the Hindu newspaper. In the Economic Times, you will have special focus on the economics of whatever is up to date. Then economic survey by which is published every year will give you a glimpse of the current scenario and the status of the economy of India. There are two magazines which are published, Kurukshetra and Yojana. These Kurukshetra and Yojana magazines, which I have shown here on the screen, and the economic survey I have shown here. So economic survey and Kurukshetra, they will help you to get a glimpse of the various social sector initiative schemes by the government of India. So these social welfare schemes should you should have a thorough knowledge, so that you know you are in a better position to understand the various social sector initiatives for the welfare of the people, whether the government of India is fulfilling its role as a welfare state. Let us see some of the questions which can be asked. Which of the is not true about Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana? So again, this is dealing with the social sector scheme. Then centrally sponsored scheme Ayushman Bharat is a national health insurance system for what sector of people? So if you have read about the scheme on the, you know, Yojana or even in the newspaper, you'll know it is for the poor and the vulnerable sections. The program of Swachh Bharat Mission is implemented by which ministry? Is meant for which segments? So it is the unorganized workers. So these kind of questions, the schemes, the economic position. May I request the participants to be on mute, please? May I request?
Please follow the minimum guidelines. Abhavat Mallikarjuna, please mute.
Thank you.
Mallikarjuna, please.
Na, jodo na.
Obliged. Yeah, thank you, sir. So now let us come to the general issues on environment, ecology, biodiversity, and climate change. So in this, you can expect topics like environmental pollution issues, the concepts of ecology, food chain, and niche, the biodiversity, the distinct flora and fauna which occupy specific climatic zones, the tundra zone, the taiga zone, the tropical zone, the permafrost regions, what is the distinct flora and fauna, the conservation of natural resources, certain endangered species, sanctuaries, where are they located, national parks, location, then the issues concerning global warming and climate change, and the greenhouse effect. So these are the major segments from which the questions on environment, biodiversity, and climate change are generally asked. So again, I would be referring to the NCERT text. What are certain national parks? These topics and the issues. Chapters environmental issues. So these are the chapters which are very good. And apart from this, if you are going through Lucent or Arihant General Knowledge Book, they have a comprehensive coverage on the ecology and biodiversity chapters. So you can go through them. Let us have a look at some of the sample questions which we can expect. For example, thermal pollution is what kind of an issue, whether it is an atmospheric warming or heat waves or heat trapped in the atmosphere. So you have certain options, and if you know what thermal pollution is, you'll be able to answer it correctly into the atmosphere or ocean. Then another question is like, which one among the following is true about the ozone hole? So definitely ozone hole is the loss of the stratospheric ozone over Antarctica. The depletion is concentrated. So you can see this is coming in both in 2020-21. The ozone hole question is being repeated. So, you know, whatever is there in the current events, whatever parts of ecology, environmental issues, biodiversity issues are there in current are also asked in the section on environmental geology and ecology. So which of the following ecosystem has the highest net primary productivity? So this is all available in NCERT textbooks. Once you have a basic knowledge of the environmental problems and the eco zones into which the world has been divided, you are successfully able to answer that it is the rainforest which are having the highest net primary productivity. Coming to the last segment, which is science and technology, I would recommend that you of the scientific discoveries, the Nobel awards in which field they have been given, so that will also be a part of the current, and it will also be a part of the certain science questions. You should know about the advanced technology innovations which are in place. Apart from that, the fundamental concepts of physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics should also be known to the participants. So here also in this segment, whatever are the latest innovations, whatever segment or aspect of any particular scientific principle has been in place in the recent year, has been in news in the recent year, that particular aspect will definitely be asked. It will be related somehow to those principles which have been in news. So reference your NCERT textbooks from of science from 9 to 12. And if you are referring to Lucent, you have a free download PDF of Lucent available, or Spectrum, then they have a very good general science segment in which the fundamental concepts of all the branches of science have been covered. In Hindu newspaper, you have a specific segment of science and technology. So that will keep you abreast of the latest concepts of science which are being in use for new innovative technology. So let us see some of the sample questions. For example, a chemosynthetic bacteria found in submarine volcano vents is feeding on. So there are options, and you know it's hydrogen sulfide, which basic physics. Increases with increase in the length of the pendulum. Tincture of iodine, so you have something related to chemistry. And then what is not true regarding infrared radiation? Infrared radiation ke bare mein kya sach nahi hai? So these kind of questions, so some basic concepts of physics, chemistry and biology and some latest innovations is something which you can expect in the science. And if you have read about the electromagnetic spectrum and infrared radiations, then you will know the correct answer. So if you are thorough with the subject, definitely these questions can be easily answered. As a summary of whatever we have discussed from the beginning of the general study preparation session, I would say that kindly practice mock test and multiple choice questions from the GK books, which I have told. The magazines like Chronicle are also publishing a lot of questions. And you have the previous year question papers of general studies, also of the combined geoscientist examination, also of any other examination. So you can practice from them, keep abreast of the current events, work on both speed and accuracy so that you are able to finish the paper on time. Through the entire question paper first so that you are able to understand how much of the questions you are familiar with the answer. Carefully read all the options because you have negative marking. Then you can discuss about the elimination technique. If there are four options, if you don't know which one is correct, you at least know which is not correct. So if you are able to eliminate three options out of four, then obviously the fourth one is the correct one. And keep the negative marking in mind. Therefore, please ensure that if you are not, knowing the correct answer, please do not go for, outright guesswork. Try to make an intelligent, informed, factual selection of the right answer. Thank you. With this, I would like to end the session. As far as my discussion part for this is concerned. So I just hope this particular session and suggestions regarding preparation of general study will be useful to the participants in cracking the exam. Thank you so much.
You can take up a few questions.
Yes, sir. I was thank you so much for listening attentively. May I request the participants, if you have any particular query related to this part, I can take a few questions, and we will also be having a dedicated interactive session tomorrow. So later on also, if you want, either just now or later on, I welcome the participants with your queries, which I will be ready to answer. I must thank all the participants, in fact, for your patience and attention.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, I have one question. Ma'am, we have to go through the old NCRT or the new NCRT. There is a confusion. Means in, I have gone through many means.
I know. I got saying, your. Yes, I got your point, sir. Thank you so much for asking, because it will be the same for all the participants. So, Amanji, I also have the same opinion. As far as the facts are concerned, they have been dealt in a more thorough manner and in a more in-depth manner in old editions of NCRT. However, when you're talking about, because it depends on subjects, when you're talking about subjects like science, where a lot of information is required in the latest aspect, okay, then if you talk about social development, if you talk about human geography, if you talk about economic geography, if you talk about the latest political changes which have taken place, so these kind of latest updates, you have to refer the latest NCRT text, because they are updated. Now, if you talk about history of India, now history is something which remains same, only the expression may change. So the expression is more in-depth, it is more detailed in the old text, because they are, as you can see, they have dealt with each topic in an in-depth and more thorough manner. There is more elaboration on every topic. And that is the reason many of the people suggest that, especially for India and ancient history and medieval history and also the national freedom struggle, try to go for the old text, because they are more elaborate. And therefore, I will suggest that for the subjects like science and human geography and political science, try to give the new one. For history, you can go for the old one. I hope you are satisfied, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am. And means that for the dynamic topic, we have to go through for the new books, and the static part, we need to stick to the old ones. Okay. And one more question, ma'am. Regarding the current affairs, means if I'm going to give the exam on 2022, means then from when, ma'am, I need to start the preparing for the current affairs if I'm going to give the exam next year?
Again, I would say, if you talk about history, if you talk about certain aspects of geography, like physiography, geomorphology, physical divisions of the country, of the world, rivers, lakes, you know, all these kind of things, then that will be the same. But definitely the current events are more focused on the previous year. For example, if you're appearing in 2022, if you're appearing, so the entire events from January 21 up to your exam in 22 will be the focus area from which the current events will be asked mostly. But it's not, you know, you cannot make a general statement regarding this. The reason being is, it is up to the paper setter. We can only talk about the trend. So the point is that regarding history, basic concepts of science, the basic geography, the basic constitution of India, the political system, and the various commissions, all this will remain static. So you can start preparing. The current events, definitely it's not that they will not ask, because the trend is that, because up to today, the current event has already been asked in this recent combined geoscientist examination. So you generally expect the current event of the previous 1 year will be more in focus. More in focus, I'm saying. And only for the current section. The rest, you have to be thorough. So there is nothing like they cannot ask you something about the past Olympic Games. They can definitely ask you. But for the current event section, it will be restricted to 1 year. I hope it is answered, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nidhi. I think we can take one more question and then we'll
see. Good afternoon, ma'am. Yes, my name is Shiva Sisam from Kolkata. Ma'am, am I audible?
Please,
ma'am, my question is that in the preliminary examination, is there a separate cutoff for the general studies paper like we see in the civil service paper 2, or the cutoff is made by adding either of the papers 100 plus 300?
As per the notification of the examination is concerned, they have said that they have a cutoff for each paper. So let us expect that there will definitely be some cutoff for the general studies paper also as per the notification. Okay. And every year, for example, the notification which is presently available is for 2021. Examination. So now for the next year, like supposing if the notification comes out of 2022 examination, again they will mention. So this is definitely mentioned, and one needs to thoroughly go through the advertisement which the UPSC gives in the announcement for a particular examination, in which they clearly mention. They will not mention what the cutoff is, but they will definitely mention that they what kind of pattern they will follow for the selection. So the selection criteria which I have shared now is based on the notification for 2021 examination, and for 2022 examination, again the commission will publish the selection criteria, and we have to keep ourselves abreast of the latest announcements, and if there are any changes that need to be taken care of. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nidhi, for a wonderful session. I think we can take a quick biological break and back.
Hello.
Maybe within 5 minutes. We are ending this particular session. Yes, please, a quick question we can take.
Hello, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. I am from Kolkata. I would like to say that is there any free archive for the book or anything else?
Archive of the books.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, actually. That I think it's better that if you go for the books either online, or if you are having those books purchased, and I think you need to have a collection of them on your own if you want to study, because the reference material, especially for the current, will keep on changing, as I said, and the NCRTs have also been revised. So I think you should go for this particular aspect, keeping it in mind, rather than going for a pre-archive of that. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you.
Sir, I have a single question.
Have an interactive session, sir. Can Actually, we take
yeah,
it?
Yeah. We'll take it. Yes, as you rightly pointed out, we have an interview. Interactive session tomorrow afternoon, where all the newly joined officers of GSI will be answering the question along with our faculty members. Nidhi ma'am will be also there. So we'll clear all your doubts. Keep your questions ready for tomorrow's session. In meanwhile, we'll sharply join within 3 minutes with our chemistry team who have joined recently cleared UPSC 2019. And we'll be sharing the technical details, the especially required for preparation of the chemistry paper. Please be online and come back within 2 minutes. In the meanwhile, I request our officers from chemistry stream, Mr. Kosta Vajra, Ms. Paramita, sorry, Pranamita, Ms. Nayanika, Mr. I'm forgetting his name. Excuse me. Sorry for that. Be online. Be ready. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
We'll start within a couple of minutes. When the geology session starts?
Yes, sir.
Geology session will start in the afternoon. We have two distinguished speakers from 3 to 3:30 and 3:30 to 4. After that, geology will start.
Okay.
And tomorrow morning, we'll be having a detailed discussion on geophysics and followed by again a detailed discussion by Nidhi Madam on how to prepare for the exam, especially the mains part. And then there will be interactive session on one of the interviewer who happened to be in the interview board of UPSC for a couple of years. So he will be telling his perception as an interviewer, and then followed by we'll have the 12 officers who have recently cleared the UPSC, and will be taking your questions. Then you can interact with them, maybe in group. So Kaustubh, let me introduce your team. Here you can see on the screen Mr. Kaustubh Hazra. Now, along with him, Kaustubh, can you share your PPT screen?
Yeah, sure.
Along with him is joined by Ms. Pranamita, Ms. Nayanika, and Mr. Chirojyoti Guha. So you can see them immediately. And they will talk about the preparation for the prelims and mains of the chemistry paper that you have. I have already confirmed somebody is reaffirming it, whether geology time, geology session time in afternoon. Sorry, I cannot give you exact time in the geology session because after the distinguished speaker finish their session, we'll start the geology session. Yeah. You have the four speakers, the four toppers of UPSC 2019 batch for the chemistry stream, Mr. Kaustubh Hazra,